A hoopster on the heron, Banny Higgins, Queen Ushlug, Sakorja, Tamor and Onard Dunman Desha Oil, Ta An Ohasurm, Gwil Tose Eg Tahulin, Felsunuk the Vonuskuln and the heron. And I really wanted to just take this opportunity today to thank the President and Ms. Higgins for all the work and support they have done publicly to help the case for establishing philosophy in schools. I don't know, do you all remember what it was like to be a teenager at school? I was very, very shy in secondary school, and I only remember once plucking up the courage to ask a question about my learning. I think it was about the Ballad of Reading Jail, and I was firmly put in my place and told to learn off the set answer for the exam. And I never remember asking another question during my secondary school, so it's a long time ago. But to me, questions were a sign of bad behaviour when I was growing up at school. It sounds very dramatic, but philosophy has changed my life at least twice. Firstly, the day I walked into a Richard Carney lecture in philosophy in 1990 in UCD by accident. I was looking for someone. And my imagination was awoken and introduced to these radical ideas of Camus and Kierkegaard and Sartre, and basically blew my mind, to be honest. And despite everyone's protests about the uselessness of a philosophy degree, I left economics, which I was studying, behind and pursued this new anarchy in thought. And the second time it changed my life was when I was challenged to bring calm and reason to a very disruptive group I had in another school, not this school. it was about 8 or 9 years ago. The students simply couldn't speak to each other, and they couldn't sort anything out without conflict. I had tutor time every morning, half an hour every morning, which is a long time. And I started sitting in the circle in the morning and let them generate their own questions that they wanted to investigate and take a vote. They loved this, taking a vote. It was their class. They weren't going to listen to me anyway. And using thought experiments and ancient Greek stories as stimulus, it really opened the door to the reasoning. And amazingly, it resonated with them. I was more surprised than anyone that this actually worked at the time. And instead, I could notice they were released from this habit of trying to win points against each other, or fighting for grades, or say who was right. They practiced thinking before reacting. And it's the practice that was key. It wasn't just a workshop or going in and doing something. It was the fact that I could help them develop these habits of thinking, because we could do it every day. And I think that's actually key, which is why, like, I've been teaching philosophy for a few years as a subject, and I've done it as a workshop, and there's no comparison to doing it regularly, because it's a subtle thing. So I wanted to expand this into other schools and my local schools and Greystones, and I set on this path to teaching the short course to Junior Cert in Temple Carrick about 4 years ago. It's a new school, and they took a chance on me, and that changed my life again. So I can't really decide if I consciously started teaching more philosophically, or did I consciously teach more philosophy. And I'm not sure if I want to encourage more teachers to really teach philosophically or take the short course, but either is a start. And in Temple Carrick, the focus hasn't been on conflict resolution as such, but I was wondering how I could communicate to you today all the subtle changes. It's not like winning a rugby match or all these, but they're very subtle. So I just asked my colleagues at lunch on Monday, and they said that it simply enhances what we have already, that it connects their learning. They said that they thought it was something deep, abstract, weird thing Miss Andrews was doing down the way, but it's beginning to spill into all the other subjects, and in fact is the most natural of subject I've ever taught. I teach business and German and digital responsibility and English, but this is the one that comes, it's the most natural thing to do. And it has even enriched our chats in the staff room. Two examples this week. I could give you lots of examples, but I don't want to bore you. But the English teacher came in and wanted to discuss questions the students raised about, I think you're doing Seamus Heaney, the blackberry picking. And the students had asked, why must things die? And they weren't finished. We're very fragmented in our subjects. You know, the bell goes and they're thinking, why must things die? So where do you go with those questions? And I've been collaborating a lot with Science Week this week, so with the science department, to introduce the idea of genetic engineering through P4C inquiries. It's a really powerful stimulus, a way into their learning. So before they've done a science lesson, they already have generated their own questions, and the teacher has this powerful knowledge about what they're thinking and the questions they are asking. For example, how long should the human life be extended? Would I choose to modify the genes of my children? What if you were the only child not genetically modified in the future? These were some of the things that they came up with. So I could go on and stand up here today and tell you all the great effects of learning philosophy for young people, but we're sitting here in a type of echo chamber, I think, and a lot of us have experienced the enrichment of learning philosophy in schools. And I think today's launch is so important. All the work that we do as a community, I feel like we're a bit like the prisoners in Plato's caves, that, you know, we've escaped and run out and seen learning through the eyes of philosophy, and are running back to our colleagues who are still looking at the shadows in the cave. but I'm quite excited always to try and somehow communicate that to other teachers. Finally, my last point I just wanted to make is I felt a bit guilty standing up here dining out on the photo I got taken with my students and the president last year at this event. It reminded me of many of the inquiries we have in class about what is real. If I didn't get a photo with the president, did it happen at all? We non-digital natives may laugh at how superficial that sounds, but for the exclusion teenagers feel when they're not part of the online world is very real. And often, if there isn't a picture, it doesn't matter if it happened IRL in real life. So I did feel guilty wasting time when we could have been having a conversation. But I wanted to let you know that our young people need these positive role models. Can you think of many others they have in public life that seek wisdom and truth? They need to feel that their voices matter, that people in positions of influence can hear them. To see you, the President of Ireland, stand alongside these disruptive minds last year in the photograph not only doubled the uptake of philosophy in the school. I had to give up business studies to but sent a very powerful message that their questions are important, just even that visual representative, and that they do matter to Ireland's future. So Gurv Míle Maith Agat Arís Don Deis Seo, Gurv Míle Maith Agat.